Tonight on Life on the Rock, we have Anthony Esolen, part one. We'll hear a reflection from Brother John and much more. Welcome to Life on the Rock. Tonight, our guest is Dr. Anthony Esolen. He's a professor at Magdalen College. And tonight, we're talking about masculinity, gifts particular to the men. If there are complementary differences between men and women, together we can work together and fulfill our vocations in Christ.
A lot of that's kind of been obscured here in our culture, but really reclaiming those gifts is important, especially in the spiritual life. So we're now going to a faith playbook.
Welcome to the Faith Playbook, where holiness meets the gridiron.
What's your game plan? Well, today we'll be talking about fortitude, which is a moral virtue that will help us overcome our natural fears. Now, fortitude is one of the four cardinal virtues, along with prudence, justice, and temperance. But this virtue is very important because it will help us overcome a lot of our obstacles that we face in life, especially with temptations. Now, one of the things that I like about fortitude, and really in a relationship to football, is that with that game, it's easy to get psyched out. A lot of times you have jitters before the game, and a lot of times you can be plagued with fear in many ways. One of the things that, with time, with experience, is that as you get out onto the field, a lot of these fears actually go away. You kind of wonder, why was I afraid before? And that's because you're actually growing in the virtue of fortitude. You're conquering these fears. You're not afraid to get a little bit dinged up. You're brave, but you're not a coward, and you're not reckless either. You play with a level head, and you kind of persevere with the goal. And that's the other thing about virtue, is that it's going to help us cultivate that virtue of perseverance. Now, in our walk with the Lord, you know, a lot of times we will be discouraged or find ourselves struggling with any kind of temptation. And whenever that happens, we actually have to turn to cultivate that sense of fortitude in our life. That's really important because this will help us kind of reclaim our senses, that we're not so distracted or discouraged, but that we persevere in choosing the good, which is also bridged off of prudence and knowing how to discern what is good from what is evil. Until next time, fight the fight, keep the faith.
Well, Dr. Anthony Esolen, welcome to Life on the Rock.
Hello, Father. It's great to be back here.
Yes, and you unabashedly speak boldly about masculinity. It's like we're embarrassed to talk about it today, but you're writing books and articles on it, and I think it's so important to talk about it, to let men realize the gifts they have and to develop them.
Yeah. If it were only a matter of men and what they have to put up with, well, I might shrug and say, well, let them deal with it. But we're talking about boys. And they're vulnerable, and they need direction. And young men, too, who are completely at sea.
Right. And one of the points you make is one of the gifts men have is one of strength. And you see that as so essential to understanding masculinity. Talk about that for us, will you?
Yeah. I've recently read it in quite another context. From a scientist who studies these things, that human beings actually had to be as big as they are, because even if we were somewhat smaller, we would never have been able to do the lumbering and the mining. We wouldn't have foundry skills. We wouldn't have been able to do the essential work to build up a civilization. Now, it seems to me that that's true, and he was talking about human race. He wasn't talking specifically about men in that article, but that's what he meant. If men had only the strength, the physical strength of women, we would not be here now. That is not enough. When you think about it, if if men, grown men, had only the strength of 14 or 15 year old boys, we would not be here now. But 14 or 15 year old boys are stronger than their mothers. It's that physical strength is absolutely necessary. You want that building there, you want that road laid down, you want to plow that field behind that ox, a man's got to do that. Okay. Doesn't get done. Even the buildings we have now do not get done without the strength of men.
In your book, you, no apologies, you talk about the great project to bring water to New York City. Describe that, a thumbnail of that for us.
Oh, yeah, I mean, this is amazing. And, you know, about the same time that this was going on, a woman who I admire very greatly, a writer about art and music, said, she was actually saying this in the whole fight about women's suffrage, and she took the opposite side. She says, think what a civilization would be. Would there be any civilization at all if there were only men? Men only do the things they do for the sake of women and children. Men wouldn't care. So in New York City, the population had grown so great that people could no longer get enough water from the roofs of the tenements. So we needed an aqueduct to get the water from Croton Dam, about 20 miles away, into New York City. And this required lots of construction work underground, even some means to siphon the water underneath the Hudson River to get it to come back up again into New York City. Huge amounts of work, thousands and thousands and thousands of tons of stone, of lumber, dangerous work too, and complicated work, so that, you know, you just don't add a piece here and a piece there. The whole thing had to be conceived from the very beginning. And why would men do this? They wouldn't do it for men. They do it for their families. They right. do it for the women and children and the common good.
Right.
By themselves, they just live hand to mouth. They wouldn't care.
Right. It gives them a greater goal, right? A project, a family, and, you know, women and children.
Yeah.
And those physical gifts of strength are accompanied too by, you know, mental gifts to accompany that, to direct that, to guide that, right? We could say maybe like specialization
right.
and focus and drive.
Yeah, you know, I just read, and again, this is in another context, we weren't specifically talking about this subject, but boys in the bay, in little boys, baby boys in the crib, right? Newborns, before any socialization occurs, will be more fascinated by a mobile hanging from the ceiling with the various things moving in concert with one another than they are with the human face. And there is something about the male intelligence that is fascinated by the single thing that is made up of many simultaneously moving but very different parts, all coming together to form some whole thing that is not at all the sum of the individual things. It's conceived of something as an organic whole. I mean, this is the kind of thing that I find going on in great epic poems, in the music of Bach, in the paintings, cycle of paintings by Michelangelo in the Sistine Chapel ceiling. It's hard to explain these things to people in our time who have very little sense of the grandeur of a kind of vision like that. But I think it's peculiarly masculine. And why should, I mean, if God has given to men these gifts, he's also given them, we are also fallen creatures, we're prone to sin too. And that same kind of move towards abstraction can be harmful in our sinful nature, right? As men even forget the people in front of them because they're lost in their imaginations or something. But still, we ought to give honor to the gift. If women have gifts, we ought to give honor to them too, and not try to pretend that each sex is exactly like the other. That just makes everybody unhappy.
Right, and it seemed like too in men, you know, they can just seem to apply themselves to a task and, you know, push aside all personal relationships sometime and just focus. I love the story you tell about the chess player that he was playing like 25 games simultaneously blindfolded, and he won like 16 of them.
Alekhine. Yeah. Frank Marshall used to play not blindfolded, but simultaneously 150 games. I mean, that's a kind of, and it's that it's the same kind of mind. And I don't necessarily want, if you're a woman, to be married to such a person, because that's going to be a trial. But Thomas Edison, you know, he was of that sort. He would get 2 or 3 hours of sleep a night, sometimes on the table in his laboratory, right? He wasn't the greatest father in the world.
Right.
There you have that kind of that masculine drive to accomplish some complicated task, but it's grown, it's overgrown. Now it was put to good effect. I mean, it assisted the common good, right? We have electric lights and so on. But you know, would be great is to have that and have it rightly channeled and directed towards both the common good and the honor and glory of God. And of course, not neglecting your own while you're doing this, not neglecting your family.
Right. Right. Yeah, I think that's a great point, that humanizing element of the feminine brings into it to order it to service of the human person and things is so critical. They need both, right? And just like you, the history of New York is just filled with those kind of, like Edison bringing electricity or the canal system to get the goods in and out of New York. And just to be able to bring all these people together in the history of New York is just like incredible that they could live so densely and concentrated. You need technology.
Right. Right. Yeah, well, my mind goes to those wonderful pictures of the building of the Brooklyn Bridge, where you have five or six men on a girder hanging in the air a couple hundred feet above the ground eating lunch.
Yeah,
you know, and that bridge, I think, went up in a year and a half. That too requires the simultaneous organization of very different activities towards one great end. Without hierarchy, that's another thing I do talk about. Without hierarchy, none of these things gets done. It is impossible to build a bridge without hierarchy. It's impossible to dig a drainage ditch that will actually drain rather than back up and flood your field without hierarchy. Nothing of that sort gets done without the coordination of many activities and submission to authority so that the things are done in their proper order and done right.
Okay, well, Hold on to that thought because we have to take a short break. We'll come back and talk more about that.
Okay.
Well, Dr. Esolen, let's talk a little bit more about teams and hierarchy and sabermetrics. What are sabermetrics?
It's funny that you should mention sabermetrics. That's the term coined for the very close study of baseball statistics. And if you've never really encountered them, it is unbelievable. If you go to a certain page on the internet where baseball statistics are logged, and you click on a single player, what you have there on the page, hundreds and hundreds of numbers just for one player. And those hundreds of numbers have been compiled from thousands and thousands of individual actions on the field and compared with other hundreds of thousands of actions by other players in the field. It's unbelievable complexity. And for something that's just a pastime, a sport. But that's, in many ways, that's the way men are. That's the way boys are. Even if you're not good at math, that's sort of the way you are. And the statistics themselves are not just thrown out there, one thing equal to another. They're all ranked also. And the players get ranked. And so there's hierarchy in the statistics. There's hierarchy in the game itself. A baseball game cannot be played. Football is even more like this. It cannot be played without a chain of command and obedience, ordered towards the good of the whole. And once you see that, then you see, aha, that's what an army platoon is like. That's what a construction crew is like. That's what a Renaissance art studio was like, right? Which was governed by the master or the master, a couple of masters, it's one family. That's what Thomas Summa Theologica is like. That's what perhaps we might say the brotherhood of the apostles chosen by Jesus was like. Because Jesus did not say to the 12, you're all equal to one another. He said, whoever would be greatest among you must become the slave of the others. But he did say that there would be greater and lesser in the kingdom of God. And that's not itself a bad thing. He chose Peter out of the 12. He chose Peter and James and John out of the 12. Right? And he chose the 12 out of his many disciples. Right.
And men are naturally function well as a group, right? It helps them individually, and as a group, we can accomplish more. I see that in religious life all the time. Right. It's like we live in community, bring different gifts and talents. I can do more, you know, with more people to help me in my role in the community. And men are drawn to this, aren't they?
I think they're drawn to it when it has the structure of a team. That doesn't mean a bunch of people getting together to pitch in their 2 cents worth. I mean, a team that's a real team, like a football team or a baseball team, a team that is the sort of pastime equivalent of an army platoon, of a company of soldiers. They gravitate towards that. And then it's not an embarrassment to, for instance, let's say a boy, a 10-year-old boy, who is being instructed in how to serve at mass by one of the older boys, 15 or 16-year-old boy. That's no embarrassment. It's an honor, okay? He's part of the team, and the chain of obedience goes from priest to chief, altar boy to the other boys, and it works. It works where, you know, just sort of shrugging and say, well, you do what you want to do and you do what you want to do, and we just all sort of get along. That doesn't have the same force of inspiration for boys and men.
Right. Yeah, we can, as that African proverb that's often quoted said, you know, if you go alone, you can go faster, but if you go with another person, you know, you can go farther. And you know, Adam and Eve are given that command to keep and till the garden. You know, man especially is called to govern, right? He's different from the rest of visible creation. And so, you know, if we work together, obviously we're going to achieve more. And I think, too, with men, there's a natural kind of, I don't know, we just seem like we kind of find the guys and you see how their gifts and talents and you're kind of always looking to see how you fit in and where my place is and things.
Right.
And there's this great respect for the talents of others, you know. So.
Right. And they can all be organized to get something done which is beyond any one of them and beyond all of them put together if you merely add up what they do. It's because the team is not additive. The team or the hunting party or the platoon or the construction crew do what they do not by addition, but by this complex or organization, which involves hierarchy.
Right.
It has to.
Right.
Yeah.
So So, well, this is the end of our first show. We're going to do a second show with you. We'll show it next week, the following week. And so we're talking about more of these topics about raising boys and agency. So, in some scripture, I like to get to St. Paul, 1 Corinthians. And so we'll see you next week.
Thanks, Father.
Well, Brother John, I enjoyed Dr. Esolen's humor and wit. His stories are great. And, you know, he talked a lot about masculine strength. You know, we can look at the human body. It reveals something of the gifts and calling of men with accompanying spiritual gifts to use that. And, you know, we are given the command to cultivate and till the garden, to order this world to God, to the kingdom, for his glory. So that's our mission here on earth. And men and women are gifted to do that. And men have particular gifts, as he was talking about, I think, and strength and focus and drive, determination.
Yeah. I think something too to reflect on whenever I was listening to y'all, the two of you talk, was that I know whenever I was growing up and playing football and everything, one of the things our coaches always kind of talked to us about was maturity. And that was a big one. And I think today you see a lot of this kind of perpetual immaturity, especially in my generation. I'm guilty of it myself, kind of thing. But I think men really do respond to the directives of older men, especially that, I think, formation process of really kind of being grounded in our duties in life, our obligations of what we have to take care of, what we have to protect, you know. And a lot of that does revolve around the family, and I think that's very important. And it's very easy for a man to lose sight of all of that. You know, but it's really just important to cultivate those virtues, especially the moral virtues, prudence, justice, fortitude, and temperance. You know, a lot of men do need that. And I think that's where just the gift of having those leaders before us really kind of shows that light.
Right, right. I just think the willingness to sacrifice. I mean, nothing's achieved without sacrifice. I think it's written in men to sacrifice for the family. You know, a man just feels that need to provide for his family, to protect the family, and he leaves the family in their culture today, you know, to provide work and things, and it's just in him. He doesn't feel like he's been who he's called to be without
him. I think men, just in general, like to work with their hands. They like to tinker around with a lot of things.
He talked about the importance of that.
And you see that a lot, and you see it especially when you're young. You're always kind of fiddling around with things. Yeah. But then as men grow up, they apply it to where it needs to be done, you know, and they explore those areas. They take risks. There's a lot of risks. Sometimes it's pretty fatal, but, you know, a lot of times men are willing to go that extra mile.
And have this drive to master, rage to master things. But so we send you the vineyard with a blessing. May our Heavenly Father shine his face upon you. May he give you his peace. May Almighty God bless you, the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. We'll see you next week on Life on the Rock.
surprise, I fell again, and it's even worse this time.